We have been discussing about the homogeneous nucleation and the heterogeneous nucleation, right? We have already discussed that today, okay? And we discussed that in the heterogeneous nucleation, we have to have some foreign particles present in the air, which act as a platform for the cloud droplets to grow by condensation, okay? And we have discussed that the two types of aerosols in the air generally classified in a broad way. One is the hydrophilic and another is the hydrophobic, okay? So it is the hydrophilic types of nuclei or aerosols, if they are available or present in the air, then it helps in the growth of the cloud water droplets through condensation. If they are not occurring naturally, they are not present naturally, then we try to add, such kind of aerosols by artificially spraying them through aircraft, and that is the technique used for cloud seeding or artificial rain making or the so-called weather modification, right? Weather modification, okay? And we already said that the types of condensation nuclei which are present in the air are classified according to their size, called the Aitken nuclei or the large nuclei or the giant nuclei also, okay? So we discussed that in the cloud physics, okay? When we say about the homogeneous system, that means one species of water substance, say for example, is present. It can be in any phase. It can be either in liquid phase or it can be in the frozen phase, okay? If it is more than one species, there are more than one species of aerosols present, then that's called the heterogeneous system. That's called the heterogeneous system, okay? And we also have already talked about the hydrophilic and hydrophobic, okay? So the atmosphere contains many particles, okay, that range in size from sub-micrometer to several tens of micrometers. Those particles that are wettable can serve as centers upon which water vapor condenses, okay? A surface is said to be perfectly wettable, that is hydrophilic, if it allows water to spread out on it as a horizontal film, like detergents are used for this purpose. Okay, a surface is completely unwettable, that is hydrophobic, if water forms spherical drops on its surface, like we wax these cars to make them hydrophobic, so that immediately the water droplets, spherical in shape, can form and roll down away. Otherwise, the window screen of the car will be like foggy or hazy, right? So we try to wax them, the surface of the car. Okay, now this diagram illustrates the relationship between the water droplets and the relative humidity as well as the supersaturation. In other words, from this diagram, you can see how much supersaturation, how much supersaturation is required in order to form water droplets of different sizes. Okay, these water droplets in the x-axis in micrometer, 0.012 to say 1 micrometer on the x-axis. Y-axis, you have got relative humidity on one side, and on the other side, you show the supersaturation. Okay, and as you can see, initially when the size of the water droplet is very, very small, like the embryonic water droplets that are formed because of the condensation, okay, condensation of water molecules. So for such droplets whose radius is about 0.01 micron, it requires a lot of relative humidity or supersaturation. Okay, about 112% of relative humidity or 12% of supersaturation is required for such kind of tiny water droplets to grow. Okay, but as they grow in size from 0.01 to, let's say, 0.1 to further larger raindrops, okay, then the relative humidity or the supersaturation required for their sustenance or further growth is much less, is drops down very sharply. Okay, drops down very sharply, like a hyperbolic curve. Okay, so the droplets can form and grow on these particles at much lower supersaturation than those required for homogeneous nucleation. That is talking about the heterogeneous nucleation. In case of heterogeneous nucleation, the droplets that can form and grow on is at much lower supersaturation than those required for the homogeneous nucleation. For example, if sufficient water condenses onto a completely wettable particle of 0.3 micrometer in radius, 0.3 micrometer, that means this is 0.1, let us say this is 0.3 approximately here. Okay, 0.3 micron radius to form a thin film of water over the surface of the particle. You see from this figure that the water film will be in unstable equilibrium with air that has got only 0.4%, okay, 0.4% of supersaturation. Okay, so when at a supersaturation which is 0.4% above the ambient supersaturation, it will help the water droplets to grow. Okay, will help the water droplets to grow further. If the supersaturation were slightly greater than 0.4%, okay, water would condense onto the film of water and the droplet would increase in size. Okay. The saturation vapor pressure of water adjacent to a soluble droplet, that is a water droplet containing some dissolved material such as sodium chloride or ammonium sulfate, is less than that adjacent to a pure water droplet of the same size. The fractional reduction in the water vapor pressure is given by Rawls' law. Okay, so what does it say? It says that, which we have already discussed, that the saturation vapor pressure required for the growth of the water droplets and their sustenance is much less when there is a presence of sodium chloride or ammonium sulfate in the air. And they are like acting like a condensation nuclei. Okay, condensation nuclei for assisting or helping the growth of the cloud droplets. Okay, the relationship is given by this E prime divided by E is equal to F. Okay, E prime divided by E divided by F, where E prime is the saturation vapor pressure of water adjacent to a solution droplet containing a mole fraction F of pure water, and E is the saturation vapor pressure of water adjacent to a pure water droplet of the same size and at the same temperature. Okay, the mole fraction of pure water is defined as the number of molecules of pure water in the solution divided by the total number of pure water plus dissolved materials in the solution. Okay. If you plot the variation of the relative humidity or supersaturation that is sent to a solution droplet as a function of its radius, you obtain what is referred to as Kohler curve. It is very important. Okay, the Kohler curve. We obtain the Kohler curve by plotting the relative humidity, okay, adjacent to a solution droplet as a function of its radius, okay, and which is illustrated in this diagram. Okay, in this diagram you're trying to show the droplet radius, okay, radius of the cloud droplets in micrometer versus the relative humidity and the supersaturation. Okay, this is 100%. This is 100%. When the relative humidity is 100%, the air is supposed to be saturated. Okay. When the air is 100% relative humidity, then it's supposed to be saturated. But at this relative humidity, it will not be so easy for the cloud water droplets to grow. It is pure. Okay, unless there is a presence of some soluble substance in the air, okay, the aerosols. And the function or the relationship between the water droplets versus the supersaturation required is given by these curves, which are known as the Kohler curves. Okay, Kohler curve. Several such curves are shown in this figure. Like you can see, curve 1, curve 2, curve 3, curve 4, curve 5, etc. Okay. So these curves are showing the relationship between droplets and the supersaturation for different types of aerosols or hydrophilic substances present in the air. Okay, we can obtain these kind of curves either by laboratory experiments, conducting experiments in the laboratory. We can also obtain such kind of curves by numerical models. Okay, so below a certain droplet radius, like suppose if we have 0.1 micron radius or 0.01 micron radius, below a certain droplet radius, the relative humidity adjacent to a solution droplet is less than that which is in equilibrium with a plain surface of pure water at the same temperature, that is at 100% relative humidity. Okay. As the droplet increases in size, okay, as they increase in size, the solution becomes weaker and the final relative humidity of the air adjacent to the droplet becomes essentially the same as that adjacent to a pure water droplet of the same size. And so it helps in further growth of the water droplets. So in this figure, as I said, okay, these numbers are representing different types of curves having different types of aerosol particles. It shows the variations of relative humidity and supersaturation adjacent to droplets in this curve number one, which is the blue curve number one, for the pure water. If there was nothing else in the air except the pure water, no aerosols, then as you can see from this curve, it requires a lot of supersaturation. 0.4, 0.5, so much of supersaturation is required for the droplets to grow inside. If there was no other aerosols present in the air. If the air was pure, clean, okay, blue cup, and they are sent to a solution droplet containing the following mix masses of salt. In cup number 2, the air contains 10 power minus 19 kilogram of sodium chloride. Okay, when the air contains, if we add in the air, how much seeding we should do, that is also very important, right? How much silver iodide or sodium chloride we should spray on the cloud is also very important. Okay, simply spraying too much of the salt doesn't help in producing optimum amount of rainfall artificially. Okay, so these are the theoretical curves. Okay, the theoretical curves which showed now the relationship between the water droplets and the super saturation, depending upon how much is the amount of this salt, okay, present in the air. Like curve number 2 is for the 10 to the power minus 19 kilogram of sodium chloride. Curve number 1 is for pure water. Okay. Curve number 3, this one, orange curve, is for 10 to the power minus 18 kilogram of NaCl. Okay. So in other words, you can see that when the size of the droplets have increased, say from this value to this value, okay, it has increased from this value, say this is about maybe 0.007 or 0.008 micron meter to about 0.1 micron meter, then the relationship between the supersaturation and droplets have changed. And in this case, even at a lower amount of supersaturation, the size of the droplets have increased. Okay, as shown in curve 3. Okay, 10 power minus 18 kilogram of NaCl is sufficient if the droplet size is this much. Whereas if the droplet size was much lesser, then we need more. Well, this is 10 power minus 19 is less. This is more, the power minus 18. Okay. So in order to have a rapid growth of the water droplets, you need to add, okay, you need to add more amount of water silver, NaCl, sodium chloride. Curve number 4 is for 10 to the power minus 17, okay, kilogram of NaCl. Curve number 5, this one, okay, is for 10 to the power minus 19 kilogram of ammonium sulfate, NH4 to SO4. Then another type of salt which is also used for cloud seeding. And in curve number 6 is about 10 to the power minus 18 kilogram of ammonium sulfate. So note this discontinuity. See this discontinuity. Okay. In the ordinate at 100%. See, this discontinuity is showing the radius or the critical radius required to achieve a rapid growth of cloud water droplets. Okay. If we further zoom that Kohler curve, let's say for curve number 2 and curve number 5. Okay. Same diagram. I just picked up 2 curves. Okay. Water droplet radius versus RH or supersaturation. Okay. And this is the ambient supersaturation. Ambient supersaturation. 0.4. Okay. Percent above the ambient value. Okay. So to illustrate further interpretation of the Kohler curves, we reproduce in this diagram the Kohler curves for solution droplets containing 10 to the power minus 19 of sodium chloride and 10 to the power 19 same amount of ammonium sulfate. Okay, this for the ammonium sulfate and this for the sodium chloride. Okay, so from this diagram, it shows that the sodium chloride is more favorable for cloud seeding than compared to the ammonium sulfate. Okay, because by adding the sodium chloride, you quickly achieve the larger radius of the water droplets, which will sustain it and help also in further growth of the water droplets. Okay, so they're very important cup, Kohler cup. In this figure, cup 2 and 5 from taken from the previous diagram. Okay, the cup 2 is for solution droplet containing 10 power minus 19. We have already discussed about that. The cup 5 is for this ammonium sulfate. We have already discussed about that. Suppose that a particle of sodium chloride with mass 10 power minus 19 were placed in air with a water supersaturation of 0.4%, indicated by the dashed line here. Condensation would occur on this particle to form a solution droplet, and the droplet would grow along the red curve, along this red curve. Okay, we add the initial, the sodium chloride 10 power minus 19 kilogram, then the droplet size will grow along this curve, red curve. Okay, as it does so, the supersaturation adjacent to the surface of this solution droplet will initially increase, but even at the peak in its Kohler curve, the supersaturation adjacent to the droplet is less than the ambient supersaturation. This is ambient supersaturation. And the peak in the Kohler curve is less than the ambient supersaturation. Okay. Consequently, the droplet will grow over the peak in Kohler curve and down the right hand side of this curve to form a fog or cloud droplet. Okay, a droplet that has passed over the peak in its Kohler curve and continues to grow is said to be activated. Okay, in this case, the cloud droplet is said to be activated. Okay, I think we should stop here for today, and we can continue in the next class. So about 13:50. Okay, 1:50, hardly 10 minutes for two. Is that okay? Shall we continue in the next class? I see only 7 students are present. Are you all able to hear me and see me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so
yes, sir.
We should stop for today, and we can continue tomorrow. Is that okay? We have to go a long way in discussing the cloud microphysics. Okay, so since it's already 1:30, so we'll stop for today. I'm going to stop sharing the PowerPoint. Do you have any question for today? No? Seems there is no question for today. So we shall stop. Okay? All right.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Okay.
All right. Yes, sir. Thank you.
See you tomorrow.
Thank you, sir.
Right.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you.